Now, everything old is new again. America's entertainment pop culture talk show with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
This is Douglas Viviani, of course, from Everything Old is New Again, alongside the ever-present David Cohen. David, how are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm very excited today. We have an opportunity to talk about Stanley Kramer and movies with a meaning, a director that to me was Hollywood's moral compass when he was active, and certainly we have his legacy is continuing to this day with the Stanley Kramer Award, and we are very lucky to have Karen SHARPE Kramer, his wife, on the line and joining us for the hour. Welcome, Karen.
Well, hi, Douglas. Very nice to be joining you today, and Dave as well.
Yeah, we're excited to have you, Karen.
Thank you.
I do want to introduce the audience to you a little bit and ask you a kind of a comical question, and I'm going to play a little bit of a clip here and see if you can recognize who this is.
Okay.
Sally, now that I'm going to have a house for you to live in, will you marry me?
Well, wait till I see the house, and if it's as nice as you say it is, I'll say yes. Hey, you know, I ought to fire you as a maid. Look at all the extra work you've caused. Aren't you ashamed?
Tell you the truth, Sally, no. I could keep on doing this for the rest of my life.
Karen, any ideas?
I don't.
Wow, okay.
This
will be interesting.
Well, of course, that's Lou Costello.
Oh, Lou Costello. Oh. You know how old I was when I did that?
19.
You did do your homework.
I did.
You are so right. Yes, I loved working with Lou and Bud, mainly Lou, because Lou was the worry wart. He was the really this consistent person who was in every shot and was concerned about everything. And Bud was very lackadaisical, could care less, and was always sitting over in the corner and said, "Oh, you need me now, do you?" But I love working with Lou. He was so great. He wanted me to work with him again and again and again. We really got along very, very well.
That's amazing.
So I couldn't place it. Like, man, that does sound like me, a very young me. And I couldn't place who that was. And, you know, they were really a great team and more talented than people gave him credit for.
We absolutely love him on this show. We keep referencing all the different bits and different shows that we do. I find their comedy even wonderful today. I have a little six-year-old, and we're starting to have her watch it, and I think this is going to continue. I think they're timeless.
They're timeless, and, you know, because today they sort of, I don't know, they resort to bathroom humor and humor that's suggestive, and I don't think that's so necessarily funny. Now, that does not mean I'm a prude by any means, but it just is not funny. I remember when I was at Milton Berle's birthday party a few years before he passed away, and I was his guest. I was sitting with Milton, and the comics of the day were all getting up and entertaining him, you know, like the king. And they were, and he said, "Do you think this is funny?" And I said, "Well, not really." And he said, "You know, in our day," meaning his day, actually, "and we had to really be funny. We didn't resort to this kind of humor."
We actually did a show on that, and our postulation was that when you have a little bit of, I'm going to call it censorship, or more to the point where you want to not be blue, you want to be clean, it's harder, but it may invigorate the juices a little bit and get become a little more creative.
Well, you know, we had kind of rules and regulations about that in those days, and we were sort of probably restricted. But the thing is, if you look at Mad World, it's a mad, 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 mad world. Well, Milton was, of course, one of the stars of it. If you look at that film and you see it today and it's a classic, why is it a classic? It doesn't resort to anything like that.
Exactly.
It's as clean as Abbott and Costello. It's as clean as, you know, as any of the people that were, you know, Jack Benny, because he's in it, of course, has a small part in it. But that was kind of the way we made films in those days. And I think it was, of course, we always think it was better when we were actually doing it, don't we? There's some really great movies being made today, too, and great things on comedy as well. But but the rule of thumb is it's appealing to a sort of a ticket buyer. That
right.
We need to elevate them, not go down to that level.
I agree. And another gentleman that you worked with that I'm going to play a little bit of a clip to right now did and does the same thing today.
Isn't that nice? Mr. Tuffington gave Dr. Howard and myself our jobs back. Except my empathy is cured, and I don't have to be an orderly anymore. That is, if you'll marry me right away.
Marry you? Oh, yes, doctor.
Now that, of course, is...
Ah, that's Jerry Lewis.
And who was with him?
That's Karen Sharp.
There you go.
Well, you know, I recognize that one because that's very near and dear to my heart. Actually, Jerry had wanted me for a couple of films before I finally said yes to this one, The Disorderly Orderly. But I said, Jerry, I really appreciate the offer, but the girls that work opposite you or play your leading ladies are sort of benign characters, and I don't know how to play those people. I'd like to play something that's got teeth to it.
Right.
And I'm a highly dramatic actress, and I really don't like those kind of lightweight things. So I said, can I be funny? No, you can't be funny. I said, okay. So I said, no, I'm not going to do it. Well, my father passed away, and I went back to Texas to settle the estate, and I was gone for about a year. And when I came back, I had been off the treadmill of working. You know, I was working all the time. And I was having some problems getting back into the business, so he knew he had a good opportunity here. So he called me and said, okay, I know you need a job. I know you're looking for something. And he said, come and join me. I'll do this, and I'll triple your salary. I'll, you know, blah, blah, blah. It was an offer I really couldn't refuse. And I said, yes. He had the most glamorous set I've ever been on in my entire career. He had music plugged into the set, you know, between takes.
Wow.
He was the one that invented, actually, the monitor. It was on that film, the first film that I'd ever seen that, or it had ever been done.
So that they could play back quickly what was taped.
Yeah, we did the scene. He didn't like to rehearse. And luckily for me, I'd done a lot of live TV when it was truly live. So I didn't need to rehearse all that much either. I could be very spontaneous with him. And he didn't always stick to the script, which was fine with me. He didn't like to rehearse anything. He liked to do it. And then we would run off set and look at what we just shot and say, is that good? You like it? Are you happy? Yes, I'm happy. I'm happy. And it was over. We did it, you know. And I love working with him.
That's terrific. And I was going to cut you off just because of a little bit of a time issue. The question I have, though, or to let the listeners know, is there has another significance to Disorderly Orderly in your life?
Yes, I should say so. While I was working on that in that film and having lunch in the commissary every day, there was this long table over in the corner when I would see, you know, Simone Signoret and Oscar Werner and Lee Marvin and Jose Greco, and then in would walk Vivian Leigh. I mean, Lord, she was like my idol. And I spent the whole time looking at that table, not even being able to eat lunch. I was so fascinated with those people. And I kept thinking, well, that's that director, producer, what's his name? I could never think of his name. Anyway, Elizabeth Ashley asked me to come in and visit her on the set. Elizabeth Ashley was also in that film called Ship of Fools. And I said, okay, it's a closed set. She said, well, that's okay, just come on over anyway. So I took one afternoon when I got through early, and I walked on to that closed set. Stanley Kramer had the whole ship there. I mean, I don't know if you've ever seen the film or if your listeners have ever seen that film, but take a look at it. It's a great film. And I'm in the water part, and Vivian Leigh is actually in rehearsal. And my mouth flew open, I know. And up on the camera, I heard this voice saying, who is that?
Oh, wow.
And I thought, uh-oh, who's that? That's that producer, director, what's his name? I could never think of his name. Anyway, so I thought, oh, my gosh, I shouldn't be here, you know. So a makeup artist came over and said, you know, I think that's Karen Sharp. So he said, you can stay.
I'm sorry, Karen, if you could go back to the story. I'm sorry we had a hard break there. You'll hear music once in a while. That'll be the sort of clue.
Wrap it up a little bit?
Yeah, but please finish the story. We're on for another two more minutes here.
Okay, so I left. And a couple of days later, I was on my way to the commissary, and this makeup artist I guess I'd worked with somewhere along the line came up to me and said, Karen, why didn't you stay on the set the other day? And I said, well, I just felt a little uncomfortable. I really, you know, it was a close set. And he said, listen, he said, Stanley Kramer wanted to meet you. I said, oh, that's who that is, Stanley Kramer. I said, well, why? Isn't this film cast? And he said, oh, I don't think that's what he had in mind. And I said, well, I never get involved with those people. Anyway, he began to call my manager, my agent. He wanted to take me to dinner. And I said, get me out of this. You know, I never have dinner with anybody like that. I just don't. I said, you know, if he wants to see me, he sees me over the desk. I read for a role.
Right.
Blah, blah.
Why is that? Why wouldn't you have interest in someone in that field?
It's very different. I was very much into my work. Okay. I wasn't a socialite in the business that way. I worked all the time. I was one of those lucky people that was always had a job. I never had to worry about where my next job was coming from. It was always lined up for me. I had a real flurry of work for a long time. And I just thought, I stayed sort of out of the business. I lived in the valley. I didn't live in the heart of Beverly Hills like a lot of people do. I wanted my privacy. And so I didn't. It took him a year to get a date with me.
Wow.
Well, he earned it, and you, of course, married him, and we'll come
Nine
right back.
9 months later, I never looked back.
There we go. We'll be right back.
You're listening to Everything Old is New Again, America's entertainment pop culture talk show, with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
That's the story of, that's the glory of love.
You've got to laugh.
Welcome back to Everything Old is New Again. We are here discussing Stanley Kramer and movies with meaning with Karen Sharpe Kramer. And that is the theme to, it's called The Glory of Love, to Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. Let's just listen to a little bit of a clip of that movie.
But you do know, I'm sure you know what you're up against. Anybody could make a case, and a hell of a good case, against your getting married. But you're two wonderful people who happen to fall in love and happen to have a pigmentation problem. And I think that now, no matter what kind of a case some bastard could make against your getting married, there would be only one thing worse. And that would be if, knowing what you two are, knowing what you two have, and knowing what you two feel, you didn't get married.
Now, of course, that's the wonderful Spencer Tracy. And Stanley Kramer worked with Spencer Tracy quite a number of times.
Oh, yeah.
I guess I'll ask a simple question. Why would that be?
Well, because he was the best actor there ever has been, as far as Stanley was concerned. And I think a lot of other people will validate that. I know for myself, I was always in love with him when I was a little girl going to movies and never understood why somebody else was getting the girl and he wasn't, because I always thought he was so great. But he could, you know, no one could say a line like he did, like what you just heard him say.
Right.
You know, when we made Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, that was the first film right after Stanley and I were married that we made together. And, you know, interracial marriage was against the law in 16 states.
Mm.
And he kept lying to the studio, actually tap dancing out of giving them the screenplay, because he knew that once that they read it, they would cancel the film, because it's not a good investment for a studio to invest in a film like this and not be able to play it in 16 states or get, you know, have a lot of radical reviews about it. Luckily for us, in the middle of when they did read the screenplay, we were already shooting in San Francisco. We thought we were somewhat safe because the crew was, you know, in place and the actors were all in place, all of that, and we were actually shooting the film, and they read it and they canceled the film. And so Stanley, we all had to come home. We were all so shocked. You know, this had never happened in Stanley's career, certainly. And he got an idea, and he went to Kate Hepburn, and he said, look at Kate. They're using Spencer's health as a reason for why they're canceling it, and it's valid in a way, because he's not well, but he wasn't well on Inherit the Wind, Judgment Nuremberg, or Mad World either. But we really know the reason they're canceling is because it's against the law in 16 states. I'm going to put up my salary as collateral to insure Spence. Will you do the same? And she said, is that important to you? And he said, absolutely. She said, then I'm going to do it too. And so did Sidney Poitier. And then we went to Columbia and said, okay, the film is insured. They had no other legal reason that they could come up with not to go ahead with filming it.
Well,
so we finished the film. They tried to bury it into a theater that had been in renovation for 3 years. They didn't even know it was open. But interestingly enough, the minute those doors opened, the lines around the block were some 15 blocks long. It's one of the highest grossing films of all time.
Absolutely.
And that film helped change the law.
And it took place basically in one or two rooms of a house. And that was so wonderful about it. And I think what's so wonderful about Stanley Kramer and your ability to produce and direct a movie that captures the, of course, with the actors that you had as well. But, you know, to create a scene and an environment where the camera doesn't have to move around that much. We're talking about people talking and listening. And that is what was the most important thing.
Well,
his films
were normally character driven.
Yes, exactly.
They were not, you know, Spider-Man kinds of films. There's nothing wrong with those kinds of films. They're very entertaining. But his films were always about subject matter. He had, you know, 35 films of content, they're called, or social issues.
Right.
And those 35 films garnered 85 Oscar nominations from the Academy.
Amazing. Even had ability to impress none other than Mr. William Shatner. I have to have a Star Trek reference.
Shatner.
Here is a
Judgment
question.
At Nuremberg. It was a monumental moment in my life. It was a great film. I had a great experience. I cherish the memory of Stanley Kramer. The memory of that movie and Stanley will be in my mind forever.
Uh-huh. There's
Who
our
did
Star
he say
Trek.
That? I didn't know this.
I did a little research.
And surely did.
Thank you.
Well, Mr. Shatner, I mean, we all have come to absolutely adore him, you know what I'm saying?
He
was a very serious actor when he started on the scene, I remember, because he's, you know, part of my generation there. And this was, in Judgment at Nuremberg, this was quite a break for a young actor to work with the quality of the people he was working with, opposite Spencer Tracy and Marlene Dietrich and Judy Garland, all those great people. It was a great break for him, but he was a great plus to the film as well. You know, that film had, I think, 12 or 13 Oscar nominations. And when Stanley was in the Army and in the photographic unit of the Army in World War II, he had privy to see those films, those terrible films about those poor people that were, you know, died in such a tragic way and were being bulldozed into ditches and whatever. And he was so shocked. The public had never seen that. And Judgment Nuremberg was made just 14 years after the war.
Mm.
Nobody wanted to make it. Nobody wanted it. We'd had enough war movies, you know. And we had. We had a lot of war movies during the war. And this was after the war, and nobody wanted to see anything like that again. But he was determined to make it because he felt that those films needed to be seen. And he actually took many of the transcripts from the actual trial that happened in Nuremberg. There were many trials in Nuremberg after World War II. But Stanley chose the judicial system, the learned men, the men of justice, who sanctioned.
Absolutely,
many
and that movie had quite a number of stars, including Burt Lancaster, talking about the individual responsibility of being silent.
Absolutely.
What about those of us who knew better? Why did we sit silent? Because we loved our country. What difference does it make if a few political extremists lose their rights? What difference does it make if a few racial minorities lose their rights? It is only a passing phase. It will be discarded sooner or later. Hitler himself will be discarded sooner or later. And then one day we looked around and found that we were in an even more terrible danger. What was going to be a passing phase had become the way of life.
And that's what I love about this movie is there's much more to it than that, of course, but the exploration as to why this happened, how it happened,
exactly.
How it possibly could happen again, you're silent, you know, the silent majority that, you know, can have a problem and not do anything about it, and look what happens.
Well, look at the world, you know. I could have warned you after World War II that genocide would never happen again. But look at it. It's everywhere. We have this problem in other countries. I don't know. We seem to not gotten past the caveman. We sort of have that in our DNA, I think.
Absolutely. I think Maximilian Schnell even discusses that in this movie.
Why?
Well,
did we succeed, Your Honor? What about the rest of the world? Did it not know the intentions of the Third Reich? Did it not hear the words of Hitler's broadcast all over the world? Germany alone is not guilty. The whole world is as responsible for Hitler as Germany. It is an easy thing to condemn one man in the dark. It is easy to condemn the German people to speak of the basic flaw in the German character that allowed Hitler to rise to power, but at the same time, comfortably ignore the basic flaw of character that made the Russian sign pacts with him, Winston Churchill praise him, American nationalists profit by him.
We could clearly see, even just hearing a few minutes of that, why the Academy Award was presented to that gentleman, no?
Oh, absolutely. We weren't familiar with Maximilian Schell in this in our country. He was more European, right. And but he was phenomenal, and that speech was so well written by Abby Mann. And I don't know if it was taken from the transcripts of the actual trial or not, but it was certainly reflective of actually what was correct.
Yes.
We were making deals with Hitler. The whole world was not paying attention to him.
But think about Stanley Kramer and his capability to bring so many of these issues out, mm-hmm. which is the reason why when we come back from this little break, we're going to talk about more of the Stanley Kramer Award and how the legacy is continuing to this day. We'll be
Thank
right
you.
Back.
Okay.
We're back for 1 minute, and then we take our big break. In this 1 minute's period of time, is there anything from the world that you have seen? Well, let me put it this way. Did Mr. Kramer come home from work, so to speak, and speak to the family about what was going on? Or it sounds like you were right there with him along the ride.
I was, but Stanley, when he came home at 6 o'clock for dinner every night, I never discussed the business. Hmm. He was totally with the kids and the family and didn't want to go into it.
That's terrific. And how did you learn so much about all of the background of what's going on with all these movies?
Well, I saw them too, and he discussed right. them with me, but and I was involved with a lot of it. And I asked questions too. I learned so much from this man. By example, he had the most integrity of any human being I had ever known.
Excellent. We'll be right back in 2 minutes.
Now, back to America's entertainment pop culture talk show, Everything Old is New Again, with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
In a child's power to master the multiplication table, there is more sanctity than in all your shouted amens and holy holies and hosannas. An idea is a greater monument than a cathedral. Mr. Brady, why do you deny the one faculty of man that raises him above the other creatures of the earth? The power of his brain to reason.
Okay, and we're back from Everything Old is New Again, and that is Spencer Tracy and Inherit the Wind. Mm. And we are having a wonderful evening discussion, and we are so happy to be talking about Stanley Kramer and his legacy with, at this point, Karen Kramer, his wife. And we'd like very much to ask you to follow up a little bit on that
sure.
quote. What does that bring to mind with you?
Well, what it brings to mind is that argument is still going on. That argument goes on quite a bit on the Christian stations about how dare that Stanley Kramer make that film about Darwinism versus traditional religion. And of course, that's not what the film was about at all. It was actually about the First Amendment and our right to explore all possibilities. That's what that film was about. I mean, you can't say, can you not explore Buddhism or Christian Science or Science of the Mind or any of the things that you want to worship. You know, we live in a free country.
I also think that gave some kind of accreditation towards the idea that we all have the power to think and think what we wish,
yes,
and to express
and
those ideas.
And choose.
Right.
That's what our First Amendment is about.
And it's a shame that it's such a simple idea that becomes so complicated somehow.
Controversial. It's going to stay controversial. It always has been and continues to be.
But what a powerful movie that I think should be shown in every school. And Nuremberg should be shown in every high school.
The people that chose to, it was really from a Broadway play.
Right.
And Stanley took it, and he did many excellent Broadway plays. And he was very great with trials, by the way.
Yes.
And it was mostly the trial on Broadway, but Stanley opened it up, you know, and broadened the scope of it. And, of course, it was with Spencer Tracy and Frederick March, who were wonderful, and an interesting role for Gene Kelly. It was adapted, actually, for film by two blacklisted writers. And Stanley had actually hired these two blacklisted writers right in the height of the McCarthy era to writing these the Defiant Ones, and that was in 1958. So Stanley hired two blacklisted writers. He did not change their names. He paid more for their screenplay than had been paid for any screenplay in 27 years. Brought them onto the studio lot, which was also unheard of. And then he put them in the movie. They're the truck drivers in the beginning of The Defiant Ones, driving the prisoners, you know, Sidney Poitier and Tony Curtis to prison. And when it went to screenplay written by, he just went right to their close-ups and put their name right under it.
It's my understanding. Go ahead.
Yeah, he broke the blacklist. They got the Academy Award for it. Then he rehired them to write Inherit the Wind. So it was Stanley Kramer in 1958. Kirk Douglas made a contribution as well as Otto Preminger in 1960. One for Exodus, which was before Spartacus, and that was Otto Preminger hired Dalton Trumbo for that. And then Kirk, who takes credit for all of it, hired Dalton Trumbo for Spartacus. But in actuality, it was Stanley Kramer. And when the American Legion came very down hard on Otto and Kirk, Stanley took up the mantle. He was his spokesperson. He said, look, at one time I was not independent. I had started as an independent. I wanted a contract to Columbia Pictures, but I had no say-so. I'm an independent again. Otto is an independent, and so is Kirk Douglas, and we'll hire anyone we damn well please. And he was the spokesperson. It went AP. It went all over the world. So it was Stanley who never took credit for it. But because he wasn't that kind of man, he just did it. He didn't speak about, look what I did. But I'm his wife, and he isn't here anymore, and I want history to be recorded properly. He broke the blacklist.
And that's why we're here, and we'd love to have you back at any time to continue with that. On the other side of the fence, I would say that, or in addition to that, he was an individual. If people don't know, he was an entrepreneur, of course. He was an individual that sort of was for the solo, the man standing up against all the odds, just like High Noon. And I don't know if you had some experience with High Noon. Of course you did. What did you feel of that movie?
Well, it was right in the heart also. It was made in 1952. It represented, I think, the McCarthy era, what was happening to people who were blacklisted because they felt so totally alone. And it was a story of a man who did the right thing. He stood up and said, that's not going to happen. And in his little jurisdiction, that little town of Hadleyville in the West, and defended the town, you know, single-handedly. So that film is not really a Western. It's really a triumph about a person standing up, and we don't stand up as much today as we used to. I'd like to see us stand up a heck of a lot more. But that film really represented, I think, the McCarthy era and how so many people felt about it. It was Grace Kelly's very first movie. She'd done a couple of television shows. It had introduced her to the American audiences. Cady Hurata, who was Hispanic. She didn't even speak a word of English. She learned everything phonetically so she could do the movie. And it brought Gary Cooper, who was really sort of considered a has-been at that time, back into focus because he got the Academy Award for it.
Right.
It's a worthwhile movie. I'm in the process of remaking it.
Well, that's terrific.
I think people need to take a look at it, not because I want to remake films necessarily. It's not my thing. But I think that's an important subject to look at again. I don't know if I'm going to do it in the West. I've written it both ways. I have a modern-day version of it as well. And that's standing up.
We're looking forward to you visiting with us again to talk about that when you get closer to releasing that. It's very exciting. I wanted to just do a little bit of a segue into talking about Inherit the Wind and the movie The Great Debaters, which won one of the winners of the Stanley Kramer Award recently. Mm-hmm. Let's just listen to a little clip here of the two movies juxtaposed to each other.
Okay.
Of the law, I say that you cannot administer a wicked law impartially. You can only destroy. You can only punish. And I warn you that a wicked law like cholera destroys everyone it touches. Its upholders as well as its defiers.
My opponent says, nothing that erodes the rule of law can be moral. But there is no rule of law in the Jim Crow South. St. Augustine said, an unjust law is no law at all. Which means I have a right, even a duty, to resist.
No, I don't know if there was any actual intention by the creators of and writers of Great Debaters to hearken back to Inherit the Wind, but I think that the groundwork was laid there beautifully.
Oh, I think so. That was Denzel Washington, you know.
Yes.
And I gave him also an award for Antoine Fisher, which was about foster care and the dangers of it. The award was started by me. I founded the award in 2000 when Stanley, just before Stanley passed away, at the Producers Guild, because even though Stanley considered himself more of a director, he was always a producer before he was ever a director and producer-director. And I thought that we needed so badly to reflect the times of which we find ourselves now. And film is a great medium to be able to expose issues. And nobody was doing it.
Right.
And so, you know, I lectured. I did a lot of public speaking and finding little by little. But we gave it to some great movies. I Am Sam. Antoine Fisher was Denzel Washington's debut as a director, by the way. And again, I gave it to him for this film, The Great Debaters. Good Night and Good Luck, George Clooney's film, which I thought was great, about Edward R. Murrow. Inconvenient Truths, about global warming, whether you believe it or not. I do. You know, In the Land of Blood and Honey, Angelina Jolie's movie, which I think was exquisite. She was her first movie, directorial producing movie, and she also wrote it. I've been very lucky. My daughter, Catherine, and I have founded the award, and we've been very lucky to have the Producers Guild accept our choices.
Terrific. We'll be back right after this.
You just shut up and let me talk!
Hey, now, Mom, come on now. What's going on there? Where's Russell?
Don't even mention Russell when I tell you what Russell did.
Just tell him about the dough, will you?
Will you keep out of this? Now, shut up!
Sylvester, don't talk. Just listen.
Hey, Mama, who's with you? Who are you talking to, and where are you?
And will you shut up a minute so I can tell you what happened?
Now, listen, Mama, you listen to me close. You stay right there, because I'm coming now. I'm coming to get you right now.
Will you shut up and listen?
Mom, it's all right. Everything's going to be all right, Mom. Your baby's coming to get you. You just sit there. Sit there. Relax. Take it easy.
Sylvester!
Coming to get you, Mom.
Shut up and
everything's
going to
be all right.
Well?
Exactly like your father. A big, stupid, muscle-headed moron.
Ethel Merman and Dick Shawn. Karen, you tell me. I know this is very hard, but to me, they stole the show away from all of these terrific comedians. Am I wrong?
Everybody has a favorite. I don't think there's any one person who stole it, because Jonathan Winters is my favorite.
There you go.
But you know something? That film never gets tired. I probably have played that more times for people. I have produced more anniversaries of that. We sell out so big. In 24 hours, we sell out every screening. And that happens all over the world. It still has legs today, because we are about greed. Look at the world now. That was in 1963. We thought we were greedy then. Well, look at us now. It's amazing. The whole world's falling apart over this same issue.
Absolutely. We'll be right back.
This is Everything Old is New Again, America's entertainment pop culture talk show with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
I never worked for him again, but I worked for him as a man and defending him and his pictures and his causes. We were just dear friends, and I miss him. There isn't a day goes by that I don't think about him.
One of the stars of... Now, that was the start us off here. It was Jonathan Winters talking about Stanley Kramer. He certainly was one of the stars of Mad World.
Touches me so much.
And it was a wonderful tribute that he just gave in a few short words.
Did. I love that man dearly, and we all did. He was a very close friend of us and of our whole family. In fact, he loved Catherine Kramer, too. My daughter, who you were playing her, she's a wonderful singer, entertainer herself. And, of course, is following in her father's footsteps.
And she, of course, was playing, she was singing Bless the Beasts and Children.
Yeah, she recreated from his film. She recreated that. She's the voice of PAWS, which is an organization for animal rights. It's they have a preserve up in Northern California where they take elephants from zoos and all kinds of animals. And she's their main voice for it. She recreated that song.
Terrific. I wonder if she's there. Would she be around?
She is, and I want to introduce you to each other. I want you. She goes by. She's Catherine Hepburn's goddaughter, actually, named for her. But like her godmother, she went by not Kate or Kathy or Katie. She goes by Kat Kramer, just like Aunt Kat. And this is Kat Kramer. And, Kat, I want to introduce you to these two charming gentlemen who I've had the pleasure of spending a little time with today, Douglas and David. Here she is. Hi, Douglas and David.
Hi, Kat. How are you?
Kat.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for playing. I heard the song just like I could just kind of like hear it through the phone.
Oh, how could you not? It was such a beautiful melody you sing, and you have such a terrific voice. It really came through so well. And I wonder, you were singing there for pause, and at some point you did that for Lily Tomlin, I believe, at another performance. Is that correct?
That's right. I did a musical. So I've actually done two musical salutes to Lily. She's an idol of mine and also like a mentor, and I've worked with her a lot on my screening series.
Yes.
So when she was honored by the Pioneer Lunch, Pacific Pioneer Broadcasters, actually, I had a salute that I created, and I just did another one for Pause, but unfortunately she was filming that night and couldn't be there, so she promised I would be able to do this new one at something coming up. So you guys will be the first to know.
Oh, we would love to have you back.
She actually is the reason I recreated and reimagined Bless the Beasts and Children. That was her suggestion. Because I'd actually sung the song, the original song on television, and my dad was actually there when we did a talk show together. Like, when I first moved back to L.A., we were both guests on a show, and I did the song, but I just did the actual, original version. And then she told me, like, reimagine it, come up with a new twist. And so I added in the Stephen Sondheim song, Not While I'm Around, because I thought the lyrics were really fitting. And even though they're covers, but I tried to make them as original as possible and make it and blend it into one song.
And you also, you also had an opportunity to work with her, I believe,
yes.
And she was a narrator of one of your projects, which was the Teach Your Children Well project, which was films that changed, it's Kat Kramer's Films That Changed the World, correct?
Yes, the full title, that's the website, www.katkramersfilmsthatchangedtheworld.com.
Yes.
And it's on a lot of these videos are on YouTube, but Lily has actually done four in a sequence with me for my screening series. She's kind of like, I guess, like you'd say, like the ambassador for it, because she's the only celebrity activist that's been really involved and hands-on herself. You know, in other words, she didn't just show up. She helped create them with me. And the first one we did was about the elephants in captivity. That is how the song came about. And then I did Teach Your Children Well with her twice because she had narrated that. And then we did Fallout was the most recent one. And that actually is about my father's film On the Beach and Nuclear Holocaust. But I have another event coming up for the screening series just in a couple weeks on April 10th. So this is perfect timing that to talk to you because, it's just recently been announced, but I'm really excited about it because I'm going to be not only honoring a film called Bhopal, A Prayer for Rain, starring Martin Sheen and Misha Barton, and that film is about the gas leak of 1984 in India that killed thousands and injured thousands of people, and, the government hushed it up. And this film is about the aftermath of that and that the survivors and their families are still trying to get justice.
Mm.
And then I'm also bestowing a new award with this series. I've never done this before, but I wanted to create an ongoing award that would be given annually to a celebrity activist who I think is really making a change in the world and using their voice for social justice. And I'm giving it to Marsha Hunt. She's 97 years old, or I should say years young.
Mm-hmm.
And, she was blacklisted. She was one of the Hollywood 10. I think she's like one of the last surviving members. But that's not the reason I'm honoring her. She had a big career as an actress, but what a lot of people don't know is that she was really the first, one of the early, if not the first, activist in the industry who really spoke out for the causes and did so many charities and was even the mayor of Sherman Oaks, and she did so much for UNICEF and for the homeless, and she never really got the credit, and she paved the way for most of the activists you see today. So I wanted to do something in her honor and bestow it on her, the first one. It's called the Hunt for Humanity Award. And I'll be giving it out annually. And I'm hoping that Lily Tomlin will be one of the recipients coming up next year.
Now, is there a website for this? We can follow along with this as time goes by?
Yes, I haven't yet updated. Okay. It's about to be updated about April 10th, because that's just in 2 weeks. But right. It's www.catcramersfilmsthatchangedtheworld.com.
Okay.
That full title. And I also have a website, katharinekramer.com. That's my full name, KathRineKramer.com. And I actually have 4 Facebook pages, too, with a lot of content.
All right. Well, we've definitely got to take a look at that and get immersed in your projects, because they do continue, from what I see, the legacy of Mr. Stanley Kramer in awarding and recognizing and promoting people that have something to say on the planet.
Well, thank you. That's why I started the screening series in his honor at the Stanley Kramer Theater, which is a small theater at Sunset Gower Studios. It's actually being renovated right now, but, you know, he started, he didn't start there. He was mainly a United Artists in the beginning, but a lot of his films were at Columbia, you know, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner and Blessed Beast and Children, a lot of his later films. And Sunset Gower, Sunset Bronson is, you know, where formerly used to be Columbia Pictures. It's the same lot. So I thought it would be fitting to start a screening series. And I, you know, my very first one was Yentl, the 25th anniversary and DVD release. It had never come out on DVD, and Barbara Streisand herself gave me the director's cut to screen the film. And that was a favorite film of my father's, too. We used to watch that because it has a strong father-daughter theme. But the reason I chose it was because I thought it had a lot to say still about women's equality, and instead of just like picking women in film or some industry organization where women need more voice, I decided to shine a light on the women of the Congo and what's happening there and how they're being brutally murdered and raped just because they're women, and show how, you know, Yentl had to disguise herself as a male just to be able to study, and here we are all these years later, and these women are having just to disguise themselves, period, and hide out just because they're women. So right. I thought that was, you know, really interesting, and I had, it was like a new way of exploring the issue, and it's still currently going on, unfortunately. You know, we haven't made that much progress, but anytime you speak out, you're calling attention to it.
Right. I also see that you are involved in some ways, so you have a couple of seconds here, for the Los Angeles Jewish Film Festival, which is screening The Outrageous Sophie Tucker on May 3rd. May 3rd, correct?
Yes, it is, in Encino at the Lemley there, yes.
So that'll be a lot of fun. We're going to take a break for a couple of seconds, and we'll be right back. We're back for one more minute, so I want to give the floor to you and at this point present to you our audience and let us hear what else is on your mind for the next 45 seconds, if you would like to do that.
After I had Yentl, I then started just screening documentaries that had social issues, and each one has had a different issue. I get the celebrities that are either involved with the film or support the issue, and the film is used as a tool to get the issues out there. And it's like a think tank. I mean, it's a film premiere that I have with a red carpet and a reception and all the hoopla, but then I have a think tank panel where it's invitation only, so I actually don't sell tickets to the public. It's invitation only, and...
Well, we can look in on you from the website, though, at Kat Kramer's Films That Changed the World. We thank you and your mom, Karen, for sharing the hour with us. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you.
And have a wonderful, wonderful afternoon.
Both of you, too.
Thank you.
Thank you.